Let me begin with a question, and the question is this. Do you understand what someone means when they say to you something like, hey, remember your fundamentals? If you've ever played a sport, perhaps still play a sport, you know that every sport has its fundamentals. But it's not just sports that have fundamentals. If you're a salesperson, I know we get a lot of salespeople in the church. There are some fundamentals that are associated with being an effective salesperson. Accounting has its fundamentals. Engineering has its fundamentals. Music has its fundamentals. Virtually every arena of life has its fundamentals. If you want an official dictionary definition, the definition is this, that fundamentals are the central or primary rules or principles on which something is based. That which is of central importance. It is often said in the world of real estate, there's just one fundamental. And that one fundamental is what? Location, location, location. All right, so here's the question. Does the spiritual life have fundamentals? Does the spiritual life have fundamentals? If you want to have life in God, if you want to grow in your relationship with Him, are there some fundamentals like location, location, location that need to be adhered to? Well, I believe the answer is yes. In fact, I believe the answer is definitively yes. And we're currently in a series that we've entitled Erosion Busters. We all know what erosion is. It's the gradual wearing away of something. In the month of August, I did several weekend messages on the life of King Solomon, significant figure in biblical history. His life, if anything, is the story of erosion, spiritual erosion specifically. Well, if you don't want to erode like Solomon did, if you want to thrive in your relationship with God, if you want to be alive in your relationship with God and grow, then I believe that there are some fundamentals that you need to be adhering to, living in line with. And I believe there are primarily three. And I want to summarize them by giving you three words, and for the sake of memory, they all start with P, all right? In hopes that you can remember them, all right? The three words are these: principles, people, presence. Principles, people, presence. Now, these are not one, two, three. These are 1A, 1A, 1A. Get the idea? These are all important, critically important. What do I mean by each of these? Well, first of all, principles. By principles, I'm referring to God's Word. He wrote a book. God wrote a book. Went to great lengths to write a book, written over 1,500 years by approximately 40 different authors. There's no other book like it. No other book like it. It's God's absolute truth. If you want to grow spiritually, then you must adhere to God's principles. John spoke about this last weekend. Now, about this, before I move on, let me say this. Concerning God's principles, there's been a great deal of erosion. For example, George Barna is a researcher. He is a highly respected and trusted researcher. He's a committed follower of Jesus Christ. I don't relate to George on a regular basis, but George and I go back about 35, almost 40 years. He attended the church that I worked in many, many years ago. George has been a researcher for many years. He's currently working as the president of the Cultural Research Center at Arizona Christian University. He's been conducting research projects for about 35 years. Well, he wanted to know not too long ago just how many people hold to what we could call a biblical worldview. What do we mean by biblical worldview? We mean, if I give you a simple definition, is a person who views and responds to all of life in alignment with God's Word. Meaning as a person sees life and as they respond to life and as they live life, they do it through the lenses of God's truth. A biblical worldview. So he wanted to know how many people hold to a biblical worldview. Well, he began with the number 300 million as our national population, of which he determined there are 256 million adults. And then through a series of questions, he discovered the following, that among those 256 million adults, obviously general numbers, that there are 179 million who identify themselves as Christians, who say, yes, I am a Christian. God is a factor in my life. 179 million out of 256. Among those 179, he determined that 90 million of those people said, I attend church. I don't know what the other 89 are doing, but whatever. That's another message for another time, okay? Then he went a step further, and through a series of questions, he found out what they believed in, how they viewed life, what they saw in life, how they responded to life, what they thought was true. And he found out that out of those 90 million, that there were 79 million who claimed to have a biblical worldview. However, through those questions that he asked, he found out that it was actually only 18 million that actually had one. 18 million people out of 256 million adults who actually have a biblical worldview. And then to go one step further, Barna broke down those numbers into some categories of population segments. So, for example, he found out that 7% of adults, people 18 and over, hold to a biblical worldview. He said among millennials, are you listening? 4%. 4%. And then perhaps the one that's most troubling of all is just 23% of all born-again Christians, meaning of all the people who said, yes, I've given my life to Jesus Christ, less than 1 in 4 lives with a biblical worldview. Now, friends, I don't know what that number is in Discovery Church. I certainly hope it's more than 1 in 4. I will tell you this. I'm out to do everything I possibly can to change that number. Friends, we need to break the curve, if you will. We need to be a people growing in our understanding of God's principles. You know, most people, in all honesty, hold to a worldview that reflects their life experience. It reflects what they think is true and what they're passionate about in their life experiences, which is why the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 12:2, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. So let me just say, if you want to be alive and growing in God, then God's principles need to take up residence in your life. John spent an entire message on this last weekend. If you missed it, I'd encourage you to go listen to it. And then second, a couple weeks ago, Ben talked about people. God's people, that's the second fundamental. True community is what we're referring to. Maybe you remember this diagram. And Ben talked about the fact that we weren't created for isolation. We were created in the image of God. How does God exist? He exists in community. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, 3 in 1. You and I weren't made in the image of God to do life in isolation alone. Nor were we made to do life in what we Ben called pseudo-community, meaning it looks like true relationship, but it's really not. God made us for true community, and if, again, we want to thrive in our relationship with Jesus, then we need to discover and find and live into true community, the kind that we saw illustrated through the life of Bernie and Karen Arribas as they shared their story. Well, today I want to talk to you about the third fundamental, and that third fundamental is presence. What am I referring to? I'm talking about God's presence, experiencing the presence of God. In Mark chapter 1, verse 35, one of the Gospels, a biography about the life of Jesus, we read a verse that at first blush seems to be insignificant. It's just a fact about Jesus. But when you reflect upon it for a few minutes, you realize that it's anything but insignificant. In fact, it's very, very profoundly significant. What we read in Mark 1:35 is this. And it's not the only time we read this, by the way. This is just one of the examples. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. So very early in the morning, Jesus gets up, still dark out. He leaves the house that he was staying in, and he goes out to a solitary place, meaning by himself, to spend time in prayer. In other words, to experience the presence of his heavenly Father. Now, you have to ask the question, why would Jesus need to do this? I mean, after all, doesn't Jesus always live in relationship with his heavenly Father? In addition to that, he's God himself. So why, as God himself, does he need to get up early in the morning while it's still dark and go spend time in the presence of his heavenly Father? Well, I think the answer is not difficult at all. It's very simply, he saw the need to spend time in the presence of his heavenly Father. Let me unpack this for you for just a minute. If you've attended Discovery for any period of time, you have heard the phrase, "Come Holy Spirit." You've heard me say on numerous occasions that I believe it's perhaps the most powerful prayer that anybody can ever utter, "Come Holy Spirit." Now, I, over the years, have had a few people who have written me or pulled me aside and said, "Don, I don't understand why you would encourage us to say, 'Come Holy Spirit.' After all, I'm a follower of Jesus, and if I understand it correctly, as you say from the front, when I gave my life to Jesus, the Holy Spirit came into my life. If the Holy Spirit came into my life, why do I need to pray, 'Come Holy Spirit?'" I said, "Well, it's a fair question. Let me take a shot at answering it." The Holy Spirit is not a thing. He's not an entity. He's a person. And as a person, the Holy Spirit and his influence upon us as a person can either be increased or decreased. We can either get more of his presence and his influence or less of his presence and his influence. And so therefore, when we pray, "Come Holy Spirit," what we're simply saying is, "Lord, I want more of your presence in my life. I invite you into my life." Let me try and give you this simple analogy I think you'll all understand. You can work with people, be in the same place of employment, pass each other, even chat once in a while, but it doesn't mean that they or you are in one another's presence. In fact, let me go so far as to say that you can actually live in the same house as someone and yet not experience their presence. True? You can pass people, even have a meal together, sitting at the same table, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you experience one another's presence. Jesus goes off in the morning by himself to experience the presence of his heavenly Father. Now, what does this look like? What does this involve? And you know, there are some times when I read the Bible and I wish there were certain things that were included. So for example, I wish that we read now in chapter 1, verse 36 and following, here's what Jesus said when he got alone with his Father. But we aren't told. We aren't given the outline of what he said. Now, I think we can look through the pages of Scripture and we can get an idea of what it means to spend time in the presence of God. Like, what do you actually do, right? So what I want to do with the first part of this message is I want to walk you through what I'll just call a template, a structure of how you can, if you choose to, get alone with God and experience his presence. So I'm gonna give you a little template. This happens to be a template that I personally use. It's not written in any chapter or verse. I'm just giving it to you as an example of what you might find beneficial, okay? I usually begin my time with the Lord with what I call presentation of self. Meaning I come before God and I say, "God, here I am, good morning. Father, I want to start today just by presenting my life to you. I want to submit and I want to surrender my life to you. I am yours today. If you're not in it, I don't want it. I want your hand upon my life. I invite you. Permeate everything in my life. Be the dominating force in my life today. I surrender myself to you." I usually take a few moments to think about the previous day and are there any ways in which I allowed temptation to get a hold of me and any way in which I said something or did something that wasn't right in the eyes of God. And I take a moment to confess, identify, and repent of those things. I think this is what the Apostle Paul is speaking of in Romans 12:1, where he says this, "I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship, to present yourself before God." This is illustrated in the life of David in the book of Psalms. He wrote most of the Psalms in chapter 27, verse 8, where he says, "My heart says to you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek." And so start by presenting yourself before God. After doing that, the next thing that I typically enter into is what I call the celebration of God. Worship and thanksgiving. taking time to take stock of who God is and what he is doing in my life. David says this. It's just one example. There are many, many psalms in which he says this, but Psalm 9, 1 and 2. I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonders. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. David just takes a moment to take stock of who God is and the wonders, as it says there, that he's doing in his life. A celebration of God. After a time of doing that, then I typically move on to what I refer to as reflecting on life. To just sit back for a moment and in the presence of God to ask yourself the question, how am I doing? Emotionally, how am I doing? What am I feeling this morning as I get up and do life? Mentally, how am I doing? What thoughts are going through my mind? Do I have any thoughts that are troubling me, burdening me? Relationally, how am I doing? Am I connected? Am I living in true community? I kind of go through different arenas of life, work and home and family and finances and just bring before the Lord. It's captured well in Psalm 139 where David says this, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting." I find, friends, it's a really important thing to take time to reflect upon life in the presence of God. Now, why is it important? Because it's in those moments of reflection when in the presence of God, God has a way and the ability to lead you in what is true. And I find almost every morning that as I spend time reflecting on life in the presence of God, that God enables me to see the truth. Hopefully that I might walk in the truth. All in favor of walking in the truth? Walk in the truth. On the heels of that, what I call next forth is conversation with God. Obviously, conversation is speaking and listening. It's both sides. Psalm 116, verses 1 and 2, we read this, "I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy, because he turned his ear to me. I will call on him as long as I live." And then Psalm 17, verse 6, flips it around. "I call on you, O God, for you will answer me. Give ear to me and hear my prayer." So this time of conversation with God is a time to bring requests before God. Time to bring requests before God. Talk more about that in detail a little later. And then finally, I end with what I just refer to as application from God. What has God said to me? What do I think I need to do in response to this time with God? Is there anything anybody need to call? Any apologies I need to make? Any decisions I need to put forth? Anything that comes out of this time that I would need to act upon? Psalm 143:10, "Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your good spirit lead me on level ground." Psalm 119:60, "I will hasten and not delay to obey your commands." You see, friends, I want to live life, and I hope you do too. I want to live life in response to the voice of God. I want to live life in response to the voice of God. That's really the goal. And I'm able to live, I believe, life in response to the voice of God when I take time like this. And so, just as a template, as an offering to you, presentation of self, celebration of God, reflection on life, conversation with God, application from God. And if you were to ask me in a single word, what is that? The word is prayer. What I've just described to you is a time of prayer. Now, does this time need to take place in the early morning? Because I read this verse, I mentioned several times that I do this in the morning, and I can hear all of you night people. And you're thinking, oh, please, don't tell me I need to get up in the early morning like before, while it's still dark? Does God want me to be awake? Would God like me to be conscious? There is no place in the Bible where it says it has to happen in the morning. God's available 24/7. However, having said that, When you read through the Bible, you will find time and time and time again, in the morning. Why? In effect, I believe what the Bible is saying to us is, start your day in the presence of God. And let your day flow from having been in His presence. I like this statement. I have it written. I keep writing it. Every new prayer journal I begin, I write this statement over again so I never forget it. You must never face the day until you have faced God, nor look into the face of others until you have looked into His. I cannot expect to be victorious if I begin my day in my strength alone. All right, so let's get really practical with this. How does this play out? Well, in my case, practical application means that I maintain a prayer journal. Some people call it a devotional journal. I've been doing this for many years. I have found great benefit in keeping a prayer journal, incredible benefit. For the sake of time, and I don't have a lot of time, I want to just list some benefits. The first one is perhaps the most important, so let me just mention what that is, and I'll briefly mention the others. I find that through a prayer journal, I have a means of organizing my spiritual life. I would assume that those of you who work, okay, all of us work, whether we're in the marketplace or whether we're working at home, we all work. Question for you. Do you have a system by which you organize your work life? Or are you just every morning flying by the seat of your pants? I'm guessing you all have some kind of a system by which you operate. Okay? I would guess that this is true of moms and dads, but especially I would say probably you moms. You know, if you got kids at home, like, do you have a system like to run your family, or does it just like get up in the morning and, oh, whatever? My guess is, and I won't do a hand raise, but if I were to ask, how many of you like have a calendar on the wall or on the refrigerator, a list of what's coming and going? You had a system of organization, right? Because you see, anything in life that matters to you, and especially if it's complicated, requires a system of organization. And yet I find it interesting that so often in terms of people's spiritual life, they have no system of organization. They just fly by the seat of their pants. Make it up as they go. Let me remind you of this truth, and this is a biblical worldview statement. This is a biblical worldview statement. You are not a human being having a spiritual experience. You are a spiritual being having a human experience. Think about that for a second. As a human being, you've got, if no tragedy strikes, 70, 80, 90, maybe 100 years. That's it. There's a dead end to that. No pun intended. But friends, as a spiritual being, you're going to live forever. You're going to live forever. So let me ask you, what matters most? 70, 80, 90 years or eternity? On top of that, we tend to look at our spiritual life as a compartment in life, as a department of our life. Like, you know, I have my family and I have finances and I have work and I have recreation. Oh, and then I have my spiritual life. Mm-mm. Friends, spiritual life is over everything. God is in all things. As Romans 11:36 says, for from Him and through Him and to Him are all things. And so I'd ask you this question. How in the world can you possibly keep all of life in order under God without some system of organization? I can't. You know, I have a lot of books. Over the years, I've accumulated a lot of books. And if you were to come to our house and look at the family room, we have bookshelves on one entire wall, a lot of books. You go up to my office, I got books. And then if I were to take you to back to Michigan, where we've got some things in storage, I have more books in boxes than I have out on shelves. Friends, all those books, not all of which I've read, by the way, all right, but all those books, the majority of them just sit on those shelves. My life doesn't depend upon them. Now, there are some of them that I, commentaries and things that I pull out and read on a regular basis. But friends, there are two books in my life that I can't live without, and it's these two right here. I don't go anywhere in life without these two books. Nowhere. You take these books right here away from me, I'm no longer me. My worldview is wrapped up, if you will, in these two books. This is God's word, his principles, and this is the outworking of his presence in my life. So an organizational system. Now there's some other benefits. Let me just mention them very quickly because I don't want any of you to leave with blanks on your message notes, because then I know for some of you that's just like a non-starter. I mean, it's just, what was point two? And you know, you don't have it. And then I get phone calls and emails and all that kind of thing. So let's just fill in your blanks, okay? Let's just fill in your blanks. You ready? Incarnation. Incarnation means to flesh out. When I keep a prayer journal, because I write in it, it forces me to flesh out what I think and feel. Do you know that when you write things, it forces you to articulate what's inside? And so having a prayer journal is a means of incarnation. Third, recognition. Recognition of self and recognition of God. It enables me to recognize patterns in my life. So for example, if I write something down and it's a temptation that I've been dealing with, and then I think, you know what, this is the fourth day in a row that I've written this down. There's a pattern here. Or if I say, you know, this is the fourth day in a row that I've confessed the fact that my mouth has gotten out of line. And you know, this is like a week now that every day I've been confessing something about my tongue. What's going on in my heart that's causing my tongue to speak in ways that I'm needing to confess it? I see patterns. At the same time, I see patterns about God. I'm able to recognize the move of God in my life, which brings me to the next fill in the blank, which is encouragement. It's very encouraging to recognize God's hand on your life. Very encouraging. And then I find that it protects me next from selfishness. I call it window living instead of mirror living. You know, most people go through life, I find, many people perhaps, looking in a mirror. They just go through life. All of life is like this. All they see is themselves. Friends, I don't want to go through life looking in a mirror. I hope you don't either. I want to go through life looking through a window. And because on my prayer journal, I have the names of people that I'm praying for, it helps prevent me, keep me from going through life just looking at a mirror. For example, I have a page in my journal entitled Healing. I counted the other day, I have 30 names on that list. Now, I don't pray about all 30 of those people every day, but once or twice a week, I take out those names and I just lift them before the Lord. Now, if I didn't have those written down on a sheet of paper, how in the world could I remember 30 names? And that's just one page. So it keeps me from being a self-absorbed person. I don't want to go through life taking a selfie. Next is priorities. I find that having a prayer journal forces me to think about what really matters in life. You know, life often causes us to focus on what I call the B priorities of life. You know what a B priority is? A B priority is something that 5 years from now won't matter. We spend so much of life just managing life, and sometimes you have to stop and you've got to ask yourself at the end of the day, how many things did I get engaged in today that will matter 5 years from now? And friends, all too often the answer is nothing. All I did was manage a bunch of activity. I find that as a result of my prayer journal, I can identify what really matters in life. I keep the A priorities of life in front of me, what really matters. And then finally, the last word, intentionality. I want to live proactively, not reactively. I want to make life happen. I don't want life to happen to me. I think too many of us were, life is happening to us instead of making life happen. So what's the bottom line goal? The bottom line goal is to live life in response to the voice of God by the power he supplies. To live life in response to the voice of God by the power he supplies. All right, so one last question before we wrap this up, and that is, so how do I organize this? I've had people over the years ask me when I've talked about my prayer journal, how do you organize that prayer journal? So again, this is just a template. Don't have to do what I do, but let me just give you a window into what I do, and it's worked for me now for many years. And I buy a three-ring notebook most years. I buy a three-ring notebook, three sections. Section one is what I simply call my Psalms, my Psalms. It's here in my Psalm section that I focus on presentation of self and reflection on life. Presentation on self and reflection on life. Why do I call it my Psalms? Because when I read the book of Psalms, I think that's exactly what the book of Psalms is in the Bible. David wrote the majority of the book of Psalms. And as you read the book of Psalms, you basically read of David's journey with God. Sometimes you read Psalms that I would call learning Psalms, where David says, I just realize I understand some truth. Let me write down what I understand. And so you read a Psalm like Psalm 1, what David learned about being a fruitful person. And then there are times when David writes Psalms of worship and thanksgiving, where he just kind of goes off in praise of God. If you read Psalm 103 and 104, for example, it's just one verse after another. Oh God, how great you are. Oh God, what you're doing. Oh God, you're wonderful. Just on and on and on. And then there are Psalms where David, I see him on his face. It doesn't say that, but I see him on his face because what he's saying is, God, I'm in a really difficult place right now and I need you. Oh God, I need you. And Psalms 34 to 39, for example, would be Psalms like that where he's just crying out in the midst of difficult circumstances in life for the freedom, the mercy, the grace of God. The ups and downs. We're all familiar with Psalm 23 where David speaks of walking through the valley of the shadow of death, right? Friends, we all in life walk through the valley of the shadow of death at times. But David then also writes of times when he's on the mountaintop. And so for me, that first section, my Psalms, is the presentation of self and the reflection on life. And if you were to read that section, you would find that, you know what, I have moments like this as well. And just like you do. Section two is what I call my God sightings. My God sightings, a celebration of God, who he is and what he's done in my life. How did God make himself known to me? Yesterday, most mornings, not every morning, but most mornings, I get up to spend time with God. And most every morning, I take a few minutes to consider yesterday. How did God show up in my life yesterday? What around my life, in my life, through my life? Where did I see God pass by my life yesterday? And I write it down. I've been doing this for many years. And then finally, section three is what I just call my requests. So this is conversation with God, an application from God. You know, it's interesting, as a younger man, when it came to prayer requests, I would get with God, I'd take out my list, and I'd bring it before God, and I'd talk, and when I got done talking, I said amen and walked away. Now, as an older man, I understand a few more things. I do a whole lot less talking and a whole lot more listening. And the reason for that is very simple. As Jesus said, your heavenly Father knows your needs. So not one time did you or I bring a need before God in which he said, thanks for telling me I didn't know. Not once. And not once after you or I have brought a request before him for the 12th straight day, does he say, thanks for the reminder. I'd forgotten about that one. Not once. Friends, your heavenly Father knows your needs. So you don't need to go on and on and on and on and on. So what does it become? Conversation with God. Here's what it becomes. You know, God, I need some wisdom related to this. And then you quiet yourself and you listen. You say, well, what happens then? Does God speak in an audible voice? Nope, I haven't heard the audible voice of God. However, in those moments of quiet, on occasion, God brings a verse to mind that brings understanding. Sometimes God brings a new idea or a solution to the problem that I have. Sometimes God gives me the wisdom I need on a matter that I'm asking him for wisdom on. Sometimes God gives me the name of a person that I need to call. God has a way through his Holy Spirit to speak into those moments in answer to that which you've lifted up before him. You see, what our requests need to be about, hear me now, friends, is not making God aware of the needs of our life, but rather our listening to find out what God thinks about our needs. It's a big difference. So, present yourself to God. Sit back and listen. So, my psalms, presentation of self, reflection on life. God sighting, celebration of God. My requests are conversation with God and application from God. I hope you see how this all fits together. All right, one final question, won't take too much time. How much time does this require? Some of you are listening to this and you're saying, wow, I mean, you know, Don, I have a job, I got a family. I mean, how much time does this take? Okay. Well, let me answer your question with a question. How much of God's presence would you like to experience? You see, you can walk through those five that I just mentioned in 5 minutes. Or you can spend 5 hours. How much of God's presence do you want to experience? I love what the reformer Martin Luther said many years ago. This is a keeper, friends. I have so much to do today that I am going to need to spend 3 hours in prayer in order to be able to get it all done. So this is my prayer journal. This happens to be from 2017. I pulled out a few of my prayer journals and I was just leafing through and I happened to grab this one because upcoming we're gonna do a series from Ephesians 6 all about spiritual warfare, and I had written on the top of this journal, warfare info. So I thought, okay, I'll read what I wrote in here. So I went to the section on God's sightings, and my first entry is January 3rd. And I won't give you all the detail, but I had written something down that there was a way in which I saw God in my son Kyle's life. I jotted down. And then I had a God sighting in my son Kirk's life. And then I had a God sighting in my daughter Carolyn's life. I had a few others. Then I had an entry for the 5th and the 6th and the 7th and the 8th. And then I didn't read all of it, but I just began to leaf through January, February was a good month. March was pretty good too. April, and the print is getting smaller because I'm concerned I'm going to run out of paper. And then May, and then June, and then July, and then August starts in August, and then September here at the bottom, and September, and October. And then I had top of the page here, Mom went home. My mother died, 10/22/17. Why would that be in God's sightings? Because my mother knew the Lord, and she entered his presence. That's a God sighting. And then I flipped there, and then I came to the next page, and it stuck out at me because I had to underline the gathering. The gathering is the quarterly, if you will, prayer meeting that we hold here and been holding here for several years. A whole church comes together. Those of you at Alpha and Winter Garden, you join us here at, in this case, Sand Lake. But in this case, I wrote down the gathering, 11/3/17, at the new ministry center, meaning we didn't have this building yet. But we were in the process. We had purchased it. And so we were going to renovate it. So we all came together that evening here when it was completely undone for an evening of prayer. And I wrote down, Holy Spirit, welcome here. And I put some of the passages of scripture that we focused on that night. And then I wrote down the presence of God was palatable. Perfect timing, God's perfect timing with commitment weekend coming up this weekend. 750 people plus in attendance, great anticipation and expectation, could feel electricity in the air. And then I wrote down in quotes, Jesus' words, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. So I finished out reading these. You know, friends, I would like to believe I would like to believe, and I would be led to believe, that God has his hand on my life. Can I tell you something? There's nothing in all of life that I want more than the hand of God upon me. What do you want more than the hand of God upon your life? The hand of God upon my life is the key to my marriage. The hand of God upon my life is the key to my being a father. The hand of God upon my life enables me to handle money in a way that honors God. The hand of God upon my life makes me a pastor that's worth following and listening to. The hand of God upon my life is the key to everything. And I would like to believe that as I go through these pages, I see the hand of God. What's that worth? I don't go anywhere without these two books. This is the foundation of life and the north on my compass. Between these is everything in life. The presence of God. So, I'm hoping to have inspired some of you to start a prayer journal. So I thought, okay, a bunch of you are going to be running out to the store getting a prayer journal, and you can't find it, and da-da-da-da-da. So, you know, we just bought several hundred. And so you can go at any one of our three campuses out to the lobby. I guess at Winter Garden and LFA, you got to go outside. But for a donation of $5, that's what we're asking, $5, you can just buy one of these notebooks, okay? And again, just as an example and my encouragement with you, God made you to relate to him. God made you to relate to him. Whether you realize it or not, God made you for relationship. Don't miss the opportunity to experience his presence. The goal of life is to live life in response to the voice of God by the power he supplies. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for designing us for relationship with you, and thank you for making it possible through your son Jesus to be in relationship with you. Father, may we not get so caught up in the busyness of life that we miss what really matters, as evidenced by Jesus himself, who, though being God in the flesh, got up early in the morning, went to a solitary place to experience your presence. May we do as Jesus did, for our sake and the sake of all we touch.